Simon & Schuster Audio presents Champlain's Dream by David Hackett Fischer. Read by Edward Herrmann.
In Search of Champlain. An old French engraving survives from the early 17th century. It is a battle print, at first glance like many others in European print shops. We look again and discover that it shows a battle in North America, fought between Indian nations 4 centuries ago. The caption reads in Old French, "Défaite des Iroquois au lac de Champlain." The defeat of the Iroquois at Lake Champlain, July 30, 1609. On one side, we see 60 Huron, Algonquin, and Montagnais warriors. On the other are 200 Iroquois of the Mohawk Nation. They meet in an open field beside the lake. The smaller force is attacking boldly, though outnumbered 3-1. The Mohawk have sallied from a log fort to meet them. By reputation, they are among the most formidable warriors in North America. They have the advantage of numbers and position, and yet the caption tells us that the smaller force won the fight. The print offers an explanation in the presence of a small figure who stands alone at the center of the battle. His dress reveals that he is a French soldier and a man of rank. He wears half armor of high quality, a well-fitted cuirass on his upper body, and protective breeches of the latest design with light steel plates on his thighs. His helmet is no crude iron pot of the kind that we associate with Spanish conquistadors and English colonists. It is an elegant example of what the French call a casque bourguignon, a Burgundian helmet of distinctive design that was the choice of kings and noblemen, a handsome, high-crowned helmet with a comb and helm forged from a single piece of metal. Above the helmet is a large plume of white feathers called a panache, the origin of our modern word. Its color identifies the wearer as a captain in the service of Henri IV, first Bourbon King of France. Its size marks it as a badge of courage worn to make its wearer visible in battle. This French captain is not a big man. Even with his panache, the Indians appear half a head taller. But he has a striking presence, and in the middle of a wild melee, he stands still and quiet, firmly in command of himself. His back is straight as a ramrod. His muscular legs are splayed apart and firmly planted to bear the weight of a weapon, which he holds at full length. It is not a conventional matchlock, but a complex and very costly arquebus à rouet, a wheel-lock arquebus. It was the first self-igniting shoulder weapon that did not require a burning match, and could fire as many as 4 balls in a single shot. The text with this engraving tells us that the French captain has already fired his arquebus and brought down 2 Mohawk chiefs and a 3rd warrior who lie on the ground before him. He aims his weapon at a 4th Mohawk, and we see the captain fire again in a cloud of white smoke. On the far side of the battlefield, half hidden in the American forest, 2 French arquebusiers emerge from the trees. They kneel and fire their weapons into the flank of the dense Iroquois formation. We look back at the French captain and catch a glimpse of his face. He has a high forehead, arched brows, eyes set wide apart, a straight nose turned up at the tip, a fashionable mustache, and a beard trimmed like that of his king, Henri IV. The key below the print gives us his name, the Sieur de Champlain. This small image is the only authentic likeness of Samuel Champlain that is known to survive from his own time. It is also a self-portrait, and its technique tells us other things about the man who drew it. A French scholar observes that its style is that of a man of action, direct, natural, naive, biased toward exact description, toward the concrete and the useful. This is art without a hint of artifice. It tells a story in a straightforward way. At the same time, it expresses the artist's pride in his acts and confidence in his purposes. It also points up a paradox in what we know about him. It describes his actions in detail, but the man himself is covered in armor, and his face is hidden by his own hand as he fires his weapon. Other images of Champlain would be invented many years later when he was recognized as the father of New France. All these images are fictions. Champlain's biographies, like his portraits, show the same wealth of invention and poverty of fact. Champlain himself was largely responsible for that. He wrote thousands of pages about what he did, but only a few words about who he was. In 2004, historian Raymond L'Italien wrote, "His activities, which were revealed mainly through his writings, were always surrounded by a certain degree of mystery." Champlain was silent and even secretive about the most fundamental facts of his life. He never mentioned his age. His birth date is uncertain. Little information survives about his family, and not a word about his schooling. He was raised in an age of faith, but we do not know if he was baptized Protestant or Catholic. After all this uncertainty about the man himself, it is a relief to turn to the record of his acts, a drama that is unique in the history of exploration. No other discoverer mastered so many roles over so long a time, and each of them presents a puzzle. By profession, Champlain was a soldier. He fought in Europe, the Caribbean, and North America, bore the scars of wounds on his face and body, and witnessed atrocities beyond imagining. Like many old soldiers, he took pride in his military service, but he grew weary of war. Always he kept a soldier's creed of honor, courage, and duty, but increasingly did so in the cause of peace. There is a question about how he squared these thoughts. At the same time, Champlain was a mariner of long experience. He went to sea at an early age and rose from ship's boy to admiral of a colonizing fleet. From 1599 to 1633, he made at least 27 Atlantic crossings and hundreds of other voyages. He never lost a ship under his command, except once when he was a passenger aboard a sinking bark in a heavy gale on a lee shore, with a captain who was unable to act. Champlain seized command, set the mainsail, and deliberately drove the ship high on a rocky coast in a raging storm, and saved every man aboard. There are interesting questions to be asked about his leadership and astonishing seamanship. Champlain is best remembered for his role as an explorer. He developed a method of close-in coastal exploration he called ferreting, and he used it to study thousands of miles of the American coast from Panama to Labrador. He also explored much of North America through what are now 6 Canadian provinces and 5 American states. He was the first European to see much of this countryside, and he enabled us to see it through his eyes. His unique methods raise the question about how he did that work, and with what result. Champlain also mapped this vast area in yet another role as a cartographer. His many maps and charts set a new standard for accuracy and detail. Experts wonder how he made maps that were more accurate than the instruments at his command. He embellished his maps and manuscripts with drawings that left us a visual record of the new world, which alone would make him an important figure. To study the few originals is to discover the skill and refinement of his art. But nearly all his art survives only in crude copies that challenge us to recover the spirit of his work. Champlain was a prolific writer. He is most accessible to us through his published books, which exceed in quantity and quality the work of every major explorer of North America during his era. They covered a broader area, spanned a longer period, and drew deeply on the intellectual currents of his age. Still, the problem is to find the mind behind the prose. In his books, Champlain played a role as a pioneer ethnographer. He left a rich body of first-hand description about many Indian nations in North America. A challenging problem is to sort out truth from error. He was also a naturalist. Champlain loved plants and animals, gathered information about the flora and fauna of the New World, and studied the climate and resources of the places he visited. He planted experimental gardens in 4 colonies. Especially important to his posterity was Champlain's role as a founder and leader of the first permanent French settlements in North America. A major part of his life was his economic association with many trading companies that paid for New France. This was Champlain's most difficult role and his least successful. Wealthy investors often defeated him, and many companies failed. But in his stewardship, New France somehow survived three decades of failure, which is not only unknown, but a mystery. Through those same three decades, from 1603 to 1630.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.